I'm Betsy Cannon Smith, class of 84, and on behalf of all of us on campus who have awaited and prepared for your arrival, welcome. We're so happy to have you here. Our numbers are significant this weekend. We expect almost 2,400 people on campus for the festivities. And the most special welcome this morning goes to our newest alumni, the 456 graduates of the class of 2016, who received their diplomas last Sunday, right outside of the chapel, on a decidedly cooler day. We can't control everything. As Biddy will no doubt remark in her comments, this is an incredibly talented and committed class that's just graduated from Amherst, so we're delighted to have them joining our ranks. During commencement, the Board of Trustees also recognized one of our alumni with a Medal for Eminent Service, and that was Kelly Close, class of 90, for her commitment and volunteer service to Amherst, most notably her work with students and young alumni. Kelly, like many of you, has mentored through Pathways, offered internships to, and employed almost 50 Amherst students in the 20-plus years since her graduation. So that may be a little bit higher than most of you. But we know this audience is filled with people who are contributing their time, efforts, and energies to our students and to other young alumni, and who do much of the same. And for that, we thank you. Let me introduce now Annette Sanderson, Chair of the Executive Committee. She's been a tremendous leader of the committee, and we thank her for committing to another year as chair. Please join me in welcoming Annette, who will take us through the business of the Society of the Alumni, so we might then turn our attention to a conversation with our president, Biddy Martin. Thank you.
Thank you, Betsy. Thank you for having me here today. Welcome, everybody. Welcome back to Amherst College. Again, I'm Annette Sanderson. I'm a member of the class of 1982, so I'm 1 year early. I'll be here next year for my 35th reunion. I don't know how that happens when I'm only 40, but, you know, so I'm still trying to figure that out. But it's great to see you all here. I imagine many of you have not been back on campus for several years, and there have been tremendous improvements, capital improvements on the campus, and we thank the administration for making that happen. They've also managed to build in some additional hills, or maybe it's just me that's feeling it. I don't know if any of you feel that there are more hills here than when you were here, but it's great to be back. And I will also say that I'm certainly honored and delighted to serve as the chair of the executive committee. I will be entering my second year next year, and I look forward to working with each and every one of you as we move our alumni operations forward. So as a reminder, the Society of the Alumni comprises everyone who has graduated from, matriculated to, or received an honorary degree from Amherst College. While the executive committee is the group charged to transact the business of the Society of the Alumni and to work in conjunction with the college to support and promote engagement, and that's referred to, quite honestly, the role in, of the alumni of the executive committee is actually outlined in this booklet that was handed to you as you entered. It's actually outlined on page 2 and 3 of that booklet. If you don't have a booklet, just raise your hand, and there are plenty of people around the room that can hand that to you. So again, the information regarding the executive committee, its mission statement, and its membership are outlined on pages 2 and 3. So now let us move forward with the actual business of the alumni. The minutes of the 2015 annual meeting of the Society of the Alumni are in my hand, and they're also available online. But I won't read them here unless it's your pleasure for me to do so. They're, as I indicated, they're actually online, so feel free to print them out and read them at your leisure. I want to refer you once again to this booklet, the booklet that was handed out to you as you entered the room, and we're going to work from that booklet for the next portion of the meeting. First of all, I'd like to thank you, the officers, and the committee members of the Society Alumni for their service to the college in the past year. Those members that have served, again, are outlined on pages 3 and 4. And a special thanks to all of those that are in attendance today who have volunteered for, supported, and engaged with your various classes for the college. Now, if you will join me in turning to page 5, of the report of the Society of the Alumni. And you'll see the nominees that have been submitted by the, you'll see the slate of nominees for the year 2016-2017. Okay. And the individuals listed again on page 5 are the nominations that have been made by the nominating committee of the Society of the Alumni. At this point, I'll ask, are there any further nominations to be made by the nominating committee of the Society of the Alumni? Any further nominations? Being that there are none, I would invite a motion that the nominations be closed. Okay, thank you. Thank you so much for that. You're way ahead of me. And that the nominations are hereby closed, and that Secretary Cannon Smith cast one unanimous ballot for the election of the officers and members of the respective committees as set forth in a report of the nominating committee.
Done.
And it's been properly moved and seconded. I thank you for that. I hereby declare that the officers and committee members are duly elected, and I want to thank them and congratulate our incoming officers and committee members. Now, on to the results of the 2016 Alumni Trustee election. And that's, please refer to page 6. I'm working off of page 6 at this point. This year's election was held to fill one vacancy on the Board of Trustees to replace the seat being vacated by Andrew J. Nussbaum of the class of 1985. The polls were closed at noon on Monday, May 16th. Out of the 23,287 eligible voters, 3,882 members of the society cast a ballot representing roughly 16.7% of the eligible voters. The alumni elected Paul M. Smith, class of 76, to a 6-year term, beginning. Paul, please stand. Thank you, Paul. Beginning July 1, 2016 through June 30th, 2022. And again, once again, Paul, thank you and congratulations. I would also like to thank Michael Kaufman of the class of 85 and Ji Young Lee of the class of 88 for submitting their names and for standing for election this year. Next, please turn, again, I'm referring to the booklet, please turn to the resolutions relating to the annual fund and the budget of the alumni and parent programs as noted on pages 7 through 9. At this point, I would ask for a motion to approve those resolutions. All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you very much. Okay. You will find a brief report on the annual fund progress to date and details of an exciting reunion challenge in pages 10 through 12. You will on pages 10 through 12 you'll find a report, and any gifts received before June 30th will be matched dollar for dollar up to $150,000 by two alumni in reunion years. Am I clear on that? I'm sorry, I wasn't clear on that myself. I just want to repeat that. Again, you'll find a brief report on pages 10 through 12, and any gifts received before June 30th will be matched dollar for dollar up to $150,000 by two alumni in reunion years. Are we clear? Okay. Now let's turn to one of the highlights of reunion weekend. We have the opportunity to hear from our president. It is my distinct honor and pleasure to welcome to the stage the 19th president of Amherst College, Biddy Martin. Please join me in welcoming her.
Good morning. I guess you had a hot night last night. I mean that only in the literal sense. Haha. I'm sorry about the weather. We have made some capital improvements, namely air conditioning in Johnson Chapel. Well, I'm really delighted to have the opportunity to talk with you this morning. Last weekend for commencement, I referred the students to some essays by Marilynne Robinson, one of my favorite American writers, and I'm going to refer to her again today. She wrote an essay called Imagination and Community, which I particularly like. It's in a relatively new volume of essays by Robinson, and in it she talks about community in the United States, and she says that alumni bodies are one of the most powerful remaining sources of community in the country. And now I'm quoting her, "We choose our colleges, if we have a choice, in order to be formed by them. And if the graft takes," she continues, "we consider ourselves ever after to be members of that community. As one consequence," this is the part I love, "graduates tend to treat the students who come after them as kin and also as heirs." Parentheses, the generosity of Amherst alumni over time certainly warrants saying that current students are your heirs. Robinson continues, "They take pride in the successes of people 40 years ahead or behind them, and they have a familial desire to enhance the experience of generations of students who are in fact strangers to them." I told the class of 1966 yesterday that I read their class book. I started reading it the other night, and I couldn't stop reading it, which surprised me. Not that your class books aren't always fascinating. They are. But the class of 66 book had some lengthy contributions that were beautiful and stimulating, and I thought I'd use them as a little material this morning. Certainly those pieces make Robinson's point about the strength of community among alumni. And in the class that's celebrating your 50th reunion, you certainly made it clear that you feel a connection not only to the college and to classes 40 or 50 years behind you, but also to one another still. Here are just a few of the entries. I'm not going to read people's entire names because I don't know whether these were meant to be only for the class of 66 or not. John D. writes, as a number of you do, that the tough-mindedness and critical thinking instilled by Amherst served me well in my career and all other areas of my life. Many of the members of the class of 66 refer to specific faculty members and specific courses, which is something that characterizes Amherst alumni in general. When I meet you, wherever it is, you almost immediately go to your memories of particular classes and particular faculty members, whereas some of the institutions at which I've worked talk about football seasons. Also important, and by the way, we've been undefeated for a couple of years here. Just saying. Paul D. writes of having been hooked on research and on writing by Professor Gagliardo in sophomore year. Richard R. says, "The years ahead, I want to be occupied by the habits of mind that I learned at Amherst. Curiosity and inquisitiveness." And then there's one entry I like a lot that I'll cover in more depth by David M., who says I learned three things at Amherst. Number one, I wasn't as dumb as I thought I was. Number two, I learned how to think with help from David Greenblatt and Joe Stiglitz, who got me through physics. Number three, with one exception, there is always somebody who can do something better than I can. What's the exception, you might ask? The exception is beautiful. The exception is saving land. This is someone who believes, now I quote him, that by definition, a truly civilized society is one where any kid anywhere can jump into any river and go for a swim. It's inconceivable to me that 40% of America's rivers are too polluted to let that happen. End of quote. Now, here's how he learned that he wasn't as dumb as he thought he was. He took a course on Shakespeare, and they were reading The Tempest. And the faculty member asked him what he thought about a passage in The Tempest. And he said, I think Charlie before me made a good point. And he didn't get away with that. So the faculty member, I'm asking you what you think. And he said, now I'm quoting, I pulled my varsity jacket even tighter around me, and I said, well, it seems there's only five of them on the island, and three of them have found a keg of booze that's washed ashore. After they've been into the keg a while, one of them says, since there's only five of us on this island, if the other two get as brained as we three, then the state totters. I thought that was pretty funny, he said to his professor. The professor's response, it's nice to find somebody in this room who truly appreciates Shakespeare. Here's one of my favorite lines. It's a good one. John S. Time has brought me an increasing appreciation of Ponce de Leon. The Fountain of Youth. Yeah, you got it, okay. He also adds that Amherst's biggest effect was probably to turn me into an elitist. I suppose that means I don't suffer fools gladly, and that seems to include most politicians. It also made me a demanding teacher, he writes. One medical student accused me of flaunting my vocabulary. I think I can blame Amherst squarely, he says, as modesty was not a notable characteristic of our faculty. The piece that moved me most probably because of my own childhood, which I'm not going to go into today, you'll be glad to hear, was David Greenblatt's piece on John F. Kennedy's visit. On the occasion of the dedication of Frost Library. And he wrote, he gave it some flavor, including, for example, that he didn't hear Kennedy because the football team in those days spent the night in Holyoke when there was a big game the next day. And he also tells us that Darp was unhappy that Kennedy went long and the stands were empty at the start of the game. He also says that he was unaware of his New England accent until people started making fun of Kennedy's diction. He was from New England. And he referred to Professor Gutman, who many of you will have known, who didn't like Kennedy's syntax and who would mock the syntax by saying, he responds to questions with, well, I would say that the answer to that question would be this. Actually, I don't know that that's incorrect syntax, but I can see not liking it. In any case, there was a beautiful contribution from John V about living with Parkinson's and what it means to decide how and with whom you spend your time when you recognize, really recognize, that your time is running out. All of the sentiments in this class book about friendship, education, and community are a balm in times of anger and cynicism, at least for me. And now I turn to Marilyn Robinson again, who says, if the effect of turbulence is to drive me or anyone else back on some narrower definition of identity, then the moderating effects of broader identification are lost. And this destroys every community, not only through outright suppression or conflict, but from within. We can all lament the shrinking of what she calls imaginative identification, because imaginative identification with people who are actually strangers to us is at the heart of what makes a democracy function. She also says a final piece that I'd like to read to you, which is the problem we have is not disagreement in the country, it's the hardening of agreement. It's the hardening of agreement, the assumptions that are taken as given on both sides. Now, I argue that the liberal arts, I'm going to argue it to my dying day, with its combination of scientific and mathematical knowledge, humanistic and social scientific inquiry, and the creative arts, is a form of education that is well suited to combat the forces of intolerance and prejudice. That was its purpose. It's an enlightenment project, and that remains its purpose. Not by exerting partisan political influence or insisting on political correctness, but on giving us the tools to free ourselves from the assumptions we bring to our education, the things we take for granted, by demanding of us that we live conscious lives, respect the lives of others, understand what William Cronin calls the power of other people's dreams and nightmares, and broaden rather than shrink our capacities for imaginative sympathy with others. Liberal arts education is education for freedom. Originally, freedom from superstition, freedom from narrow-mindedness, freedom from ignorance, which we sometimes wish to hold on to actively for all kinds of reasons. And for that reason, it should be a leading source of resistance to the anti-rational forces of manipulated fear and hatred. And what I said to the graduates is that I hope they'll use their education in that way. But everyone has the freedom not to exercise our intelligence. I'll leave it at that. Students at Amherst, I'm happy to tell you, perhaps against all odds and contrary to some people's beliefs, students at Amherst continue to get a rigorous and ambitious liberal arts education that teaches them how to use their minds critically and creatively. And for that reason, they get the education that is the best hedge against uncertainty and the best hedge against change. They are not trained narrowly for a job that might disappear in 10 or 20 years. They're educated to think. They're educated to be versatile. And the results of their education are actually astonishing. Someone asked me yesterday how we could claim that there's rigor when there's grade inflation in the United States. And I think it's a perfectly good question. Of course, being very competitive, I would say that grade inflation at Amherst, though it exists, is not as bad as it is at other places. Cambridge, for example, just saying. But here are the indicators that I think make a difference when we ask about the rigor of an Amherst education. The strength of students' honor theses, the quality of the graduate and professional schools to which they are headed, the success they have there, the reports they send that their preparation for medical school or law school or graduate school in the sciences seems better than the preparation of many of their peers. The fact that Adam Kaufman, class of 09, has just won the National Best PhD Thesis Award in Atomic Molecular and Optical Physics, as judged by the Body American Physical Society. He did his undergraduate work here with David Hall, also an Amherst alum, and was recommended for summa. But not only that, he's the latest in a long line of physics majors to win similar awards. Another one might be here now. A few years ago, Mike Foss Phi, class of 06, a summa student of Jonathan Friedman's, won the same best PhD in physics award nationally. I don't know if Mike is here by any chance, but he's apparently on campus. The disproportionate share of national awards and fellowships that our students win every year. 11 Fulbrights this year for a very small college, a Beinecke, two Watsons, finalists for the Marshall and the Rhodes, and a Schwartzman scholarship. This is the first year of the Schwartzman Scholar Program modeled on the Rhodes. There were 49 students in the United States chosen to be Schwartzman scholars, which means they will go to Tsinghua University in Beijing next year to study and then to Oxford for a second year. Three of the 49 are Amherst students, one a senior who just graduated, two who graduated last year. That's extraordinary. I also use as evidence the reports I get from those of you who employ our graduates and people who are not alumni who report about the quality of the thinking and the work of our graduates. What are our goals? And then I'll take all the questions I know you have. Well, not all, but some. Well, we want to continue to provide the finest undergraduate education available anywhere, and we will. And that means continuing to lead in providing opportunity, regardless of socioeconomic background, where we also excel and also just won a major national award. Lead in the liberal arts by promoting it, but also by reinventing aspects of it, looking at the curriculum as a major faculty committee is currently doing, looking at curricular policies, asking what students need in the liberal arts in the 21st century. Innovation in pedagogy, which is another major focus of the faculty at the moment, including the use of technological tools, but not exclusively that at all. Also asking themselves how to rethink pedagogy for a new time and with a new population of students. When our new science center is up, which will be 2 years from now, Amherst will set itself apart in undergraduate science education from other liberal arts colleges, simply by virtue of the fact that the expense and the sophistication of the facilities needed to do interdisciplinary science are not facilities or instrumentation that can be afforded everywhere. But Amherst's combination of great faculty in the sciences and the facilities that we will have will make Amherst the place to come, not only for the humanities, social sciences, and arts, but indicatively for the sciences. We're going to continue to encourage intellectual risk-taking, and we also need to promote social risk-taking on the campus to ensure that students build bridges across their differences and also that they learn what leisure and play are, because a lot of them haven't learned it at home before they came to Amherst. They haven't. We're living in a weird age, aren't we? How to even conceive of leisure and play, and then how to use those things wisely. And we'll continue to build community that acknowledges but does not create the differences among us. Finally, we have a new career center, a remade career center, that is helping students from their early days at Amherst reflect on possible careers without using those reflections to turn their education into job training or career preparation. And that is helping our students tremendously. Much of the help is coming from you. Those of you who have signed on to be mentors for our students are doing something that is the key to their futures. I urge all of you who can afford the time and would enjoy it to sign up for the Pathways program. Our students are enthusiastic about what it's bringing them. Those of you who are hosting the career treks that we've started that take groups of students to your workplaces, your firms, your businesses, your educational institutions, and actually show them what it's like to do what you do, those visits have been transformative according to some of the students who've been there. So thank you for your involvement. Please stay engaged. Take that imaginative identification and sense of community for people 40, 50, 60 years behind and ahead of you, and keep Amherst strong. Thank you very much for all you do. Any question? Really? Already?
Go ahead. Yeah. Check.
I doubt if anyone in this room could imagine being the president of Amherst College. You, to us, are an esteemed and honorable figure. What are the biggest frustrations and the greatest rewards in your position?
Oh. The greatest rewards might be easy. It's seeing these remarkable young people flourish. There's nothing like being around 18 to 22-year-olds, as many of you know. Maybe even more so if they're not your 18 to 22-year-olds. I don't know. But I love the age group. I love being at a college of this scale so that I have proximity to them. I can hold office hours. I get to talk with them about every conceivable thing that they bring to me. And I couldn't enjoy it more. If I do anything that seems helpful to them, it makes me feel like I've done something enormous, even if it's giving them enough funding to host a dinner with the students who are now living in the rooms they lived in first year. Doesn't matter. It's so that the greatest reward is seeing the students be transformed by their education and seeing them flourish. For example, I talk all the time about teaching Christian Margowski's poetry class on the German poet Rilke. I've done it twice now, just one day, not teaching his entire class. And I've said this many times, but the first time I went to that class, there were 18 students at Amherst, where, by the way, you remember we have an open curriculum. 18 students taking a poetry course on Rilke. This was my first thrill. Rilke is not easy, but the poetry is gorgeous. And they had read what I had assigned them, and I'm not exaggerating. Wait. No, that was not the surprise. Amherst students work hard. The surprise was they had read what I assigned them more carefully than my graduate students in German at Cornell had usually read them. That is, they were doing this. I would ask a question, they'd go, well, on page 14, she says XX. And then another student would raise his or her hand and said, aha, yes, but on page 22, it's contradicted. And I thought to myself, really? Wow. This is what I love about Amherst. Close reading, intensity of intellectual engagement, and hard work. It's the only place I've ever been where I see students going to the library on Saturday night. That's the most rewarding. Not all students, I know. The most frustrating is not being able successfully enough to communicate with those of you who are part of the college, love the college, and are far away, and for whom it's very hard to convey the subtleties of what might be occurring at any given time. That's the most frustrating. And, you know, we just have to keep trying to do that better and better, because lots of times the way that things can be made to seem in the media, or with just a paragraph or two description, fails to capture the nuance and the actual feel of events, and that frustrates me because I'd like everyone to have a better understanding. In an Amherst community, everyone's not going to agree anyway, but having people feel informed about the subtleties of things so that our arguing with each other can be more substantive, that would be good. That's on us, so we just have to do a better job. Yes. I don't know who was first, but I'm going to go here and then I'll come back that way. Oh, go ahead, Ellie. No, we're going to go to... Oh. I'm going to leave it up to
so
you.
So when you're talking about helping educate the student body with regard to leisure activities, which seems incredibly... That would be really odd, given my experience here. Can you?
It's not on, I don't think.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah, much better.
When you're talking about teaching the current student body about leisure activities and helping them with that would be incredibly odd, given my experience here in class of 86. And I'm just wondering if maybe that's, I don't know if that's the change of who the kids are now versus, or whether it's who you're accepting now in the student body. When we were getting accepted here, it was about Amherst looking for the well-rounded student. And now, at least what I've read, is you're looking for the well-rounded class as opposed to the well-rounded student. And I just wonder if that's true, and if maybe you were focused more on more well-rounded kids, you wouldn't need to teach them about leisure activities.
Well, here's what I would say. First of all, we look for the most promising students. And generally, they're all well-rounded. I don't think that's the issue in 2016. I think the issue is they're very well-rounded, but they're over-programmed. I mean, they've been shuttled from one kind of activity to the other. And when they get here, I think what they don't know how to use as well, according to them, is free time. It's not that they're not interested in a lot of things. They are. The numbers of activities they get engaged in sometimes worry the faculty, for example, because the amount of time they spend being well-rounded is extraordinary. And interestingly, when we were trying to design the interiors for the new residence halls, a number of them said, we want spaces within those halls that are where we can unplug. We don't want a lot of sophisticated technology that helps us get hooked up. We want actually some downtime. And I think that it's not a problem of a specific group of students. And I hear it from people at every college and university in the country, it's not Amherst specific, that students have been so programmed that when their time is their own, they will continue to do a lot of activities, often as a way of resume building, however, which really stresses them out. And at times, just going out and inventing things is different. If I said teach them how to use leisure time, I misspoke. That's not the point. What we have to do is offer them the opportunities to do it themselves. I can't teach them how to do that. It will depend on what works for them. But I'm not diagnosing them. I'm just listening to them. And this is one of the things they say. Yeah.
When I was here, I became interested in the fine arts, and of course I took Charlie Morgan's introductory course to fine arts and became very interested in things and decided to pursue my interest in that subject. And for some reason I signed up for a course in Mexican art, and so I found myself in the junior year, instead of learning about Vermeer and Franz Hals and Rembrandt, learning about Diego Rivera. And I said it was very, very unfortunate that the college included a course in Mexican art in the curriculum. Today, I notice, to the extent of my knowledge of the curriculum, a great many courses which I would call peripheral as opposed to the quintessential courses that every college graduate should know about. Could you comment on this, please?
Well, could I comment on that? I don't agree with you. I appreciate the point, but I don't agree. We live in an increasingly global, interconnected world. Our population is changing rapidly. Students need to understand, in order to understand their own history, they need to understand the fundamentals and the great works of Western culture, but also of many other cultures. We are simply not one. We haven't been for a long time in that sense. The influences on American life and culture and government are many. And the populations in the United States are increasingly many. And we can close ourselves off and say that anything that doesn't belong to what was defined as a canon in Western art 20, 30, 40, 50 years ago is peripheral, but I think that would be a mistake. We need to be in the world and to let the world into our campus. These courses are not peripheral. The other point I would make is that what faculty are really focused on here right now is the question of what intellectual skills and critical skills lie beneath the substance of any given course or discipline. And asking themselves, are we teaching in a way that gives students transferable intellectual abilities, regardless of the content? Because the truth is, there's too much information, there's too much knowledge out there in every field now to cover everything. The question is whether they, you, can go on from Amherst having the abilities to separate opinion from fact, or information from knowledge, or knowledge from wisdom. Those are the abilities that have to be the focus. Or we pretend that we can cover everything that we've defined as essential. And in this room right now, there are as many opinions about what ought to be taught in a given course as there are people, probably. So I don't agree that Rivera is peripheral. And I do agree that those other artists are great, and that one should take the... and that one should take the opportunity to get to know their work. Yeah. I think you were... Someone over here was next.
Why is Amherst College not a non-smoking campus? There are many schools out west, particularly that bastion of big over administration like UCLA, which is entirely non-smoking. And there seems to be a movement towards biodiesel, where most of what I see is actually towards electric, which is far better. And second bonus question is, why do only 40% of Amherst College students write theses?
That's a bonus question. Oh, the question, the first question was, why do we allow smoking on camp? Why are we not a non-smoking campus? Smoking is not allowed at Amherst indoors anywhere. It is allowed outdoors, is that right? Why are we not over-administrated like UCLA and ban smoking altogether? I think. I don't know, perhaps we should ban smoking altogether, even outdoors. No? There's a lot of banning these days, and maybe that's an appropriate one, but we don't do it yet. Yeah. Yeah. Well, yes, there are. It's true. As for the 49% who write honors theses, there are departments that cannot actually support more theses than are written because there are too many students for the number of faculty. And many students choose to do other things. there are increasing numbers of what are called, I hate using this because now it's already jargon, but it's true, capstone experiences of another sort that substitute for theses. And moreover, some students who have specialized early on in their major field want the opportunity senior year to take a wider range of courses in other disciplines. So there are a range of reasons for the 49%. I myself would be happy if 100% wrote theses, but the faculty knows what they're talking about, and they would probably say that's not really the best choice for every single student in every discipline. So there. Yeah. Yeah. You all should choose, because I can't. I think in the back, we're missing people in the back. They're coming to the back.
Aiming at my mouth? Yes, okay.
Yeah.
When President Kennedy was here 53 years ago, he talked about the justification for privileged institutions such as Harvard and Amherst being that so many of their graduates gave so much of themselves to public service. And I'm just wondering if, well, let's just suppose a Wellesley graduate is in the White House and she came to Amherst, would she make a similar comment today?
I didn't hear the last part.
Would a sitting president make a similar comment today, having if that president also came from a very high-level college? I think there's really a focus in our country as a whole on very elite populations who seem to be in control of what's happening. And there's got to be some sort of corrective to that situation for us to move forward productively.
Yeah. Well, I love that speech of Kennedy's. And just because of my own situation, I loved Kennedy's speeches in general, which I realize were written mostly by someone else. But I used to recite them at night in my head to myself as a kid. You know, I grew up in Virginia, and we had to memorize the speeches of every famous Virginian. So, I mean, that's probably why I got in the habit. Patrick Henry, give me liberty or give me death. Peace, peace, but there is no peace. Why stand we here idle? But anyway, I don't know if a sitting president now would come here and say, with privilege comes responsibility, but I would certainly hope so. I think probably at least a couple of them would, and maybe all of them. The question would be, what do they mean by it when they say it? I think Kennedy did have in mind specifically public service of various kinds, but I think he meant responsibility as well to those who were less privileged. And I think the fact that Amherst has 25% of its student body on Pell Grants by virtue of the extraordinary efforts that the college has made to create greater educational opportunity is a sign of the college doing its part to take the privilege of its financial strength and health and serving populations who are not served well enough by most elite institutions. In fact, when we won the Cook Foundation Award for Educational Equity, the foundation had told me straight out that Amherst was far ahead of the other finalists. So I think what the college is doing is aimed in that direction. I also noticed this year, by the way, an uptick in the numbers of students going on in fields of education, teaching in a range of different forms, Teach for America in the Los Angeles public schools and other major urban public school systems, as part of various friends schools and charter schools. So I think there's a sense of public spiritedness among our students and a desire to make things better. And I have no doubt that with their abilities, they will give back. As for presidential candidates, I shouldn't go there. I just wish, I would just say one thing that someone said last night. I don't remember at which tent party. I just wish that kindness prevailed.
Hello, following up on your last point, I was very proud to see Amherst win the award for access. Can you speak a little bit more to what it means to the school to have made that commitment? And also, in the article that I read, when they chose Amherst among the 90 or 100 most selective and presumably best endowed colleges and universities, it made a point that in many of those colleges and universities, you're now seeing actually an increase in income inequality when you look at where the students are drawn from. So just some thoughts on that would be appreciated.
Yeah. Well, there's the upside and then there are the challenges. The upside is that we're getting incredibly talented students we wouldn't otherwise get, and they are bringing experiences and forms of resourcefulness that our students benefit from being exposed to. One of my favorite examples is really our veteran population. The veterans who have transferred to Amherst from mostly from community colleges, we don't have that many yet, who come in as first-year students, but we hope to change that. And what they're doing is extraordinary. In my commencement speech, I gave one example of a young man who dropped out of high school to help take care of his siblings. He then served in Iraq. He came back and went to night school and community college to get to Amherst. He came to Amherst on a full scholarship. He just finished a thesis, which is a compilation of his own creative poetry, and is going to teach in Beijing for a year. These are the stories that are rewarding and also the kinds of people who add a great deal to the student body. During the events of the fall, the sit-in, there was a group of veterans who asked to speak with me. They came to my office. They talked to me about their views of what could be done and what should be done. And they also told me that they were trying to serve as mentors for our younger students by val-sitting a couple of them. And one of them said he was giving relationship advice. So I don't know if that was a good idea or not. But in any case, they bring experiences and knowledge that one just doesn't have otherwise on the campus. It's also challenging. If I think about the forms of social fragmentation that exist in the country as a whole, and how few solutions we seem to be able to find for them in society at large, then I think it's not surprising that bringing together students from a wide range of different backgrounds, some of which are not only different from one another, but are embedded in a long history of division and even conflict. And then you bring them to a college campus and expect them or want them to be able to make friendships, build bridges. It's not always easy. It's not easy for them. They're 18 to 22 years old if they're not veterans or older transfer students, and we're asking a lot of them. And so I think the college was prepared in some ways for the changes in the student population that have occurred and not prepared in other ways. And so we're working hard to do what needs to be done to ensure equity and also give students what they need to interact with each other. Thanks for the question. Yeah.
Good morning. Good morning, President Martin. Good
yes.
Morning. Over here. Good morning, President Martin. I'm Dr. Loris Rayner from Chicago, affectionately known by the class of 76 as Deuce. I want to ask you, how did the Amherst uprising affect you? What about it invigorated you? What about it disappointed you? And what about it changed your perceptions of the Amherst student body?
Excellent. Okay. Invigorated.
Easy question.
Actually, it is an easy question because I think about it all the time. The question is just what to say in a short amount of time. What invigorated me, you probably realize from all of the long, as students say, overly long emails I send, that I wasn't here during the day. So during the part of the sit-in in which students first began to stand up and talk about their experiences, I was in Washington on my way to Japan. So by the time I came back to campus, it was about 9:30, I think, at night. And when I got there, there were still students who were speaking movingly about their experiences before Amherst, outside of Amherst, and at Amherst. But once I arrived, the students had compiled a list of demands and they presented them to me. So I missed some of what many of my colleagues who were in the library say was most moving and even transformative to them. But I also know the students, many of them, who organized the sit-in and who spoke and have talked with them in other settings, and I know a lot of what they feel and what they're going through. What was most invigorating to me, I guess, was, what was most invigorating? The whole thing is invigorating, because the minute you have a challenge, you're either invigorated or you're not doing a good job. I mean, it's invigorating. But also the fact that tensions that have been simmering under the surface actually got acknowledged. And as the students, primarily students of color or first generation college students, talked about their own experiences, what's hard for them, why they don't have a sense of belonging at times here, where they face bias or prejudice of various kinds, there were hundreds of students in the library who were just there to listen to them. And that breaking of a kind of ice, where people acknowledge that there are problems, a lot of students from every background have later commented that it released tension and that it made it more possible, certainly not easy, to talk about the things that divide them. That outcome is invigorating. What was difficult or frustrating were the demands that they read to me that first night. I mean, they were just not Amherst student ready demands. But we worked through it, and unlike other campuses, I don't want to sound too competitive, but this just happens to be true. Amherst students who were part of the uprising acknowledged within 36 hours that they had drawn up those demands too hastily and that they didn't reflect where they really wanted to go with the challenges and the problems. And one of them even acknowledged it in a letter to the New York Times in response to the article there. I don't think many people saw it, but Andrew Lindsay actually sent a letter that was printed in the Times in which he said just that. That was invigorating. Because they're smart, they're thoughtful, they're well-intentioned, and they're calling us on things that need to have been done and that still need to be done and that we need to accelerate our efforts on. So I think on the outside, a lot of people, because of the way it was covered in the Times and because you didn't have enough information, worried that it was largely a negative event. But on campus, many, many people, and by no means every single person, but many people, regardless of where they were or how they felt in that moment, I think would say it has had a positive effect. Because it has made people's stories known to one another, and it has identified problems that deserve work. And since the students left the library on Sunday, back in November, they have worked with our governance groups, with the administration, with faculty, on the things that are really substantive and that matter to them, and they intend to continue doing that, and they'll hold our feet to the fire, as they should. So it was a respectful, I mean, the library was never closed, the library was always doing its business, pizza was brought in for the students, there was Marsh Coffee House one night of the sit-in. The students invited me to Marsh Coffee House in the library. I went, there was singing, there was dancing, there was spoken word, it was not the way it was depicted, but it was serious and also on point. Not those demands, those initial ones, but what the students were telling us about what they experience here and what they experience outside of the campus. So We're in the United States. You know, I keep saying to people when they write to me or say to me, what's going on at Amherst? I just take a breath and I say, what's going on in the United States? These are, I mean that seriously, these are issues that the country hasn't yet solved, and maybe how could we expect the country to have solved them all? But we have a mandate to work on better solutions. And colleges and universities are not bubbles. They're not immune to what's going on in the world. They never have been. There have been as many protests and sit-ins at Amherst College as there have been anywhere in the world, and maybe more over time. And that's part of life. That's part of democracy, I think. I mean, a lot of people say, what, protest? Protest is as American as apple pie, as long as it's civil, as long as it's not violent, as long as it's not getting in the way of people doing their work. That's how I feel about it. So I don't share the view that it was some sort of tragedy or a bad sign about Amherst. I actually think it was, in the course of things, it had some unfortunate moments, and overall, it has done something good for Amherst College. And I'm sticking to my story. There's someone back here in the middle, someone upstairs, and...
Oh. This is a follow-up to a lot that you've been saying, a lot of what's been asked, both in terms of the present and looking forward as far as diversity and specifically gender identity. I feel like this is a time when for alums like myself and gray hairs around, we have some work to do just to learn the vocabulary, to stay current, and to be welcoming and accepting and learn ways to do that. And I wonder if you have any thoughts or advice related to that for how, as alumni, we can try to keep up with the changing and times and the diversification. Thank you.
Well, I think that's a great question, and what I think might be helpful is to get the heads, some of our students or some of the directors of our resource centers who are very well informed about changes in vocabulary and norms and identities to make that more widely available. Students on campus really quite broadly seem to take the changes in stride and to use pronouns as people wish to have them used, and to have a pretty good sense of when it makes sense to ask and come forward with that information. But it's true that, you know, not everyone is privy to or involved in communities where those things are obvious, so we could always find ways to make it the information available, or make some information available. It's a good idea. Yes.
I will make my way to a question as soon as possible.
Oh. Yes.
I want to thank you, first of all, for bringing words and wit to this holy chamber that has known many great words. I'm also struck by the nostalgia that I'm experiencing in sitting here in the balcony where freshmen had to sit in a time of required chapel, certainly for freshmen. Amherst was capable of gathering in this room. But I also remember being in this room for those occasions when Robert Frost would grace it. His voice is here. It's throughout this room, and Frost, it seemed to me, had the consummate description for what we're going through, many of us, a lover's quarrel with Amherst.
Yeah,
and we appreciate your sincerity in helping us through that, and we know that you're respectful of ours. I was also fortunate to be in the area in 1957 when standing where you were standing was a man named Alexander Micklejohn.
Yes.
It was an extraordinary historic event for Amherst because this man who had rattled the cage of Amherst in many ways and who had departed from it for several years had returned in what was a very extraordinary event. And in the course of his comments, Alexander Micklejohn cited an English master from Eton named William Johnson Corey, who said something to the to the effect that education is what is not. We go to a great school not so much for knowledge as for arts and habits, and it's echoed and lived with me ever since that time. My question here, relative to our lover's quarrel, is will you find every way you can to see many of us through this, those of us who sat here as freshmen in this balcony, those of us who remember the presence of Charles Cole, standing where you are standing, who said, here was this man with a Phi Beta key glistening from his belt or vest, saying, the best definition, he said, I ever heard of education was that it's what you have left over when you've forgotten everything you learned.
And that's great.
I've lived comforted by that now for many years, and I sense that you are bringing as sincerely as possible and as thoughtfully as possible your presence into this matter of the lover's quarrel, and I hope you will see us through this. Just one final note, and that relates to Frost's reference to something. He might have been thinking of Lord Geoffrey Amherst, because he enjoyed the identity of Amherst in many ways, and he said in one of his poems, he said at the closing of it, he said, there must be something wrong in wanting to silence any song. For us, that's Lord Geoffrey Amherst.
Yeah.
Well done. That was a long, beautiful, winding way to Lord Geoffrey. Using every major figure in the world to get to the song. Actually, as the board's letter said, no one wants to silence songs. And it's not the job of the college or the board to silence anybody on this. And the quarrel will go on as long as it goes on, as long as people still feel upset about the mascot. The only thing that I want to tell you, because I've heard it several times this weekend, there are some people who believe that the students on campus labored or thought under the false assumption that there was clear evidence that Lord Geoffrey Amherst's notes in that letter were actually put into practice. Students worked with the archivist Mike Kelly, who helped them understand the historical evidence. And for some, it was the fact of what he said in the letter that was enough. I just want to make sure that you don't think that the students, I'm always defending the students, but really they are incredible. They went, the students who were most interested in this, to the library, to the archivist, to get information. They didn't want a mascot that was divisive. That's not a cover over, that's just the way it was. And for those of you who feel attached to the figure, yes, of course, we all always will. It's Amherst College, it always will be. It's the town of Amherst, it always will be. I think the decision that was made was right. I think it allows the campus to move on. But yes, I'll hang in there with you as long as the quarrel remains salient to people. and I hope you all will too. Let's not go the way of the rest of the country. Let's not be so angry about a decision that really is consequential at the level of emotional attachment and some of the implications that people saw in this decision. But it doesn't change anything about the respect for those who are here now, for those of you who were here earlier, and I hope not yours for them. It's a disagreement about what a mascot should be, and nobody has ever suggested that the name of the college should be changed because of the man or the name. So we're going to get through this. Okay? All right.
So following up on that exactly, can you just describe the process going forward to telling us what the new mascot's going to be and how inclusive has that been, just and when's it going to happen, just to kind of explain what comes next?
Yes, I am not involved. It's being organized by a group of the Alumni Executive Council and a group of students, and they have constituted themselves as a committee that will seek your input and the input of on-campus constituencies about whether we need a mascot, and if so, what that mascot should be. And I believe, I don't know if Annette is still here. Annette, it'll be an inclusive process that is beginning now. It has begun, and it will be very inclusive. And I hope we come up with something great. I'm sure we will. And I hope it's witty, too. Okay. But not the banana slugs, not that kind of witty. Should we stop now? Yes, one more. Okay.
Following up on this most recent subject, 4 years ago, you were challenged on the song Lord Jeffrey Amherst, and your response was great. My question, thought is, how are we going to teach those who came from the era of being a singing college to replace Lord Jeffrey Amherst with something that we can learn?
Yeah. Well, for those of us who would have a hard time learning, we could have the words on a page. But I think there are several different rewrites of the Lord Jeffrey Amherst song. Am I right? And I don't, you know, I sort of expected you all to get up and take the new words and sing it today, but you haven't. And I'm hoping that along with the mascot, there will also be rewritten songs. It is still the singing college. There's more music here than I can get to on any given evening, and that's a wonderful thing. So thank you all. Thanks for being here. Thanks for listening. Yeah.